Indian history, remarks on region and division. And today's speaker is Soumya Bratta Chaudhary. He is associate professor in SAR. So I hand over to sir, and in the session we will have a discussion. And if you have any queries or questions, you can ask.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me to speak today. Since my subject is the day itself, you know, this date, 6th December, so I don't have to make any formal preliminary introductory remarks, but having thanked you, the organization, BAPSA, and everyone else, and all of you who have come here to listen to me, and also a discussion after this. Let me start with the date. I mean, this day, 6th December, and yes, like we just heard, that this date is significant for at least two reasons in Indian history. 6th December, 1956. For the reason that Baba Saheb Ambedkar passed away that day in a particular series of contexts that were part of his life at that time, which I'll come to in a moment, and 6th December 1992, when the demolition of Babri Masjid took place, and it was something that became almost an irreversible, you know, something absolutely without remembering 6th December 1992, you, as if you cannot move on to the next day, next step in being part of Indian historical life. To live a life in Indian history, you have to go through 6th December 1992, in whichever way you think about that day, but you have to go through that day. You can't avoid it. In that sense, it's irreversible, unavoidable. So between these two years with the same date in question, 6th December 56 and 6th December 1992, there is absolutely nothing to put them in the same on the same platform to be discussed. No, it seems to be a coincidence, just a coincidence of the date. At the same time, we know that when every year 6th December comes, then whoever responds to one of the dates, by and large, also responds to the other day. This is interesting. So this is my first sort of point on through which I want to talk to you, begin talking to you. That while there is nothing common to these two dates, it's purely coincidence. At the same time, interestingly, every year, this year included, when 6th December is about to, you know, we are about to reach 6th December, whoever thinks of 6th December 1992 nearly always thinks of 6th December 1956. Whoever thinks of 6th December 1956 nearly always thinks of 6th December 1992. In that sense, there is something shared. Not objectively, not in terms of the two dates and whatever happened in those two days, on those two dates, but in terms of a kind of the future of those two dates in it, in their afterlives, the afterlives in Indian history that we are living through. You know? So let's put it this way, insofar as we are living not just a mechanical life in Indian history to today or 1992 to today, but insofar as we are living a historical life, in the sense that we are taking part in this history. We have some relationship to this history. Sometimes through memory, through reading, sometimes, of course, like someone like me who has actually lived through 1992 in some more immediate sense of having actually lived through a particular day. So there is something shared at that level. So that to me is the reason, and this happened, you know, actually in the last few days when I and Devjyoti are sitting here, we are discussing what, how we should, you know, this talk that I'm giving you, what should we speak about? Then both of us agreed that you cannot not speak of either of the two. So Ambedkar's day of passage and Babri Masjid's day of the impasse. That something happens which you cannot simply pass through. And Ambedkar's literally passing away of his life and his mortal body. So the passage and the impasse, you have to speak of both. You cannot not speak of one, and you cannot avoid the other either. So in that sense, people who we are all of us together here, in a sense sharing in this kind of otherwise completely dissimilar or, you know, nothing in common, two separate dates. At the same time, we are living them together in terms of our. So really what is at the center of today's discussion is neither 56 nor 92 simply, but us today, here and now. As people who are living a historical life, and all, like all historical life, it can only be lived in the present. So that's the first sort of horizon, which is the horizon of the present, from where I'd like to speak to you. Now, if you were to take the simple, simple question of what happened in these 2 days, into the same date on the 2 different years, separated by almost 40 years, the two are very different also in the nature of these occurrences. The death of a human being, a mortal, and the active destruction of a physical structure at a particular site have a completely different logic, no? So for instance, the death of an individual is something that is inevitable. I mean, it's obvious. The death of a human individual, a living being, is inevitable. And the inevitable happens. It happens with all of us, including someone like B.R. Ambedkar. But the kind of destruction which takes place with a particular physical structure out there, a kind of object, which otherwise does not seem to have any kind of, you know, evolution, any kind of so-called life. It's just standing there. And then one day, something happens which completely changes the landscape, and it is blown apart, it is broken down, and around it, a whole set of things happen, which are so sort of violent and noisy and create a certain kind of disorientation in all of the surroundings in society. This kind of a thing is not inevitable. So that is the second thing we have to keep in mind. That when we speak of Ambedkar's passing away, then at one level we are speaking of something inevitable. But when we are speaking of Babri Masjid, completely different from each other, no reason to speak of them together, but if we are doing it, then we have to actually speak of the kind of difference they actually constitute. So the difference of Ambedkar's passing away from the destruction of the Babri Masjid is that the second was something that was not inevitable. What does that mean? Why am I saying this? Which is obvious. The reason I'm saying this is that in the second case, clearly, it can be analyzed. It can be thought about. It can be investigated. Now, of course, with a natural death, you can have a kind of biological investigation. And with Ambedkar, that is something not unimportant, because Ambedkar was a very ill person. And his illness really exacerbated in the last many years of his life. So, of course, there is an investigation there. But the investigations are of two different kinds. One is a kind of scientific investigation, about why a person dies in certain circumstances. But the other one is a historical investigation in a very precise sense, which means what? Which means that in the second case, one, after the investigation, comes up with a kind of verdict, or at least a kind of ascription, that this is the agent, cause, subject who is responsible for this particular event, for this particular occurrence. Now, of course, in the case of a natural death, also you can say, you know, certain set of, and in the pandemic situation, that becomes so much more obvious, that a whole set of natural causes are at the heart of a certain death. But the difference is clearly that with a historical verdict, you are really speaking not of an object, but of a subject. Which means again the same thing, that when you say that X or set of X, Y, Z, whatever set of factors are responsible for the demolition of the Babri Masjid, you're again saying that this need not have been so. This has happened out of a set of contingent but real historical factors which need to be analyzed. And which has been going on since then, of course. With the case of the death of a natural being, you normally do not, after the death, having established the causes and all of that, you do not normally keep the book of that particular, you know, story open. You close the book. Yeah? But when we speak of someone like Ambedkar, Baba Sahab Ambedkar, then you know that the book is not closed at all. The book is not closed at all. On the contrary, the book is something that becomes it flies open with an even greater energy after his death. Why? Why did that happen? Not because of the death. Of course, how we speak of the death is also very important and interesting. Because, and I'll come to that in a moment. But more importantly, however we speak of the death, that death in that very moment does not close the book, but transforms it into something like a collective book. So what is interesting about a death like B.R. Ambedkar's is that the death creates a kind of new subject of history. From a natural death, a new history, a historical subject is created. And of course, that name, immediate name is Buddhist. Immediate name is Buddhist. Why? Because Baba Sahab converted to Buddhism just a couple of months before he passed away, but also because of a long process of the question of conversion into which he was immersed, and he was thinking, writing, undertaking a lot of experiments, communicating with a range of people from all over the world, which comes to a kind of culmination with the conversion at Nagpur in October, just 2 months after which he dies. So in that sense, the moment he dies, that death does not close the book, but in a sense, immediately transfigures it, makes it into a new book of Buddhism. As an immediate name, just a name to begin with. But even that name is complicated, no? It's not simply Buddhism. It's not the Buddhism which is at least 5,000 years old. But it's a new Buddhism, literally named sometimes Neo-Buddhism, sometimes Ambedkarite Buddhism. So which means with Ambedkar's death, a future is opened up whose name is Buddhism, and yet it is not the continuing Buddhism of Indian history, but a kind of, again, let me use the same word, a kind of historical Buddhism, where history is again not the history of the past, but history of the present. So in 1956, the present of Ambedkar, even in his death, is marked by the new name which bears his name. Hence we say Ambedkarite Buddhism. Now, what is then Ambedkarite Buddhism? Is it just a name? No, of course not. It is, let me just, you know, lay my cards open for you. Let me put it this way. It is a vision. It is a vision. Ambedkarite Buddhism, the name stands for a vision. I'm not saying the name describes the vision. I'm not saying the name is a formula for the vision, but it stands for a vision. It indicates a vision. What that vision is, we need to talk about. But it's a name which sort of opens up a vision at that time, exactly at his death. Yeah, but that vision is not simply a physical idea, like a miraculous idea, you know, that you see something glorious, like truth which you see in one flash. No, here it's a vision which is historical, which means we have to look at how Ambedkar spent his last several years before he died, but we have to also look at what happened after his death in the name of Ambedkarite Buddhism, such that that vision also got, again, a certain historical life, which means a movement. So that's why what's interesting is, between Ambedkar's death and the future that opens up, we also then hear of an Ambedkarite Buddhist movement. Again, movement has to be seen literally, something which moves into the future. Born by a collective subject with a name, in this case, to begin with, only to begin with, Ambedkarite Buddhist. And that becomes possible with that moment of threshold, which in one idiom, in one specific language, is a Mahaparinirvana. The moment you use that particular Pali or whatever that Buddhist term, you've already described the death in terms of a certain idea of what death is, you know, which is all right, which is absolutely something which we will do at the level of precisely being some of us part of the movement of Ambedkarite Buddhism. So we'll look at Ambedkar's death in the light of a particular Buddhist doctrine of life, death, and everything else. Yeah? But that is not to say that this particular way of characterizing the death actually exhausts the historical opening that this death creates. That's why, more or less between 1956 and 1990s, because I want to reach 1990s clearly because of the other event, there is the proliferation, no? Really, an energetic proliferation of more than one name. Ambedkarite Buddhism, Dalit anti-caste movement, Bahujan, so that a whole range of social, political, and collective forms of historical life are seen emerging from at least 1956. Now, there is a term that was used by Ambedkar himself to cover this range, to cover this wide range of historical, emergences or historical or historico-political creations, which all have a common basis, which is the basis of emancipation, the basis of raising a voice against social oppression, inequality, caste. So the term that Ambedkar used was revolution. In his own writings in Buddhism, much before he converted, he spoke of an ancient Indian revolution, which he more or less identified with Buddhism, with Buddha. That's why he spoke of revolution, and in relation to that also counter-revolution. So he spoke of revolution as creating its own reaction in the long history of India, which he also called several counter-revolutions. So in a way, Ambedkar asked us to think of what happens after him, since he's not there to speak for us. We have to speak in our own voices. He asked us to think of what happens after 1956 up to now in terms of this sequence or this sort of oscillation between revolution and what is a response to revolution as its reaction, which is counter-revolution. So in a way, between 1956 and 1992, when the Babri Masjid demolition happens, one of the ways of thinking about this entire sequence in a properly historical way, which is also a certain kind of which is a certain kind of labor of analysis, thinking based on documents, is to think of this as a contest between a revolution in Indian modern Indian history and a counter-revolution, which in a sense also overwhelms this revolution and finds its most overwhelming, violent and divisive consequence in 1992 with the demolition of Babri Masjid. That would be, in a sort of summary way, a way of looking at the sequence from a particular stage in Indian history when a certain vision of emancipation, a vision with a revolutionary project and a revolutionary sort of a, you know, impulse that came from Ambedkar and from Ambedkar later to a whole set of movements that I've already named, some of them, moving to something like a reaction, but a very powerful reaction, an overwhelming reaction in the 1990s, which was a Hindu, Brahmanical, upper caste, and eventually solidified or consolidated as an anti-Muslim, anti-minoritarian counter-revolution, whose first physical expression was the demolition of Babri Masjid. So this would be one way, just a way, of building this sequence from 1956 to 1992. But you will notice that if I'm speaking in these terms, then I'm really speaking of two factors here. One is the factor of a certain kind of vision which is embodied in Ambedkarite Buddhism or Dalit politics or anti-caste movement or the Bahujan movement and so on and so forth. And I'm speaking of something which is an upper caste, Hindu, socio-religious, with a deep anti-minoritarian ideological disposition. I'm speaking of these two poles, which is very well known to all of us. But for all historical analysis, we need not just two theoretical poles, one opposed to the other, which gives us a nice schema, a nice picture of what is opposing what. But we need an actual historical event, or at least a set of historical, factors, which explain why something like a Babri Masjid became, or the project of demolishing Babri Masjid became so important to this counter-revolutionary, Hindu counter-revolutionary reaction. What was it? So in the several analyses that have been made of this question, in the terms that Ambedkar actually spoke of, which is, of course, as some of you will notice, which is very close to the terms in which Marxism spoke, at least at that time, of revolution and counter-revolution, when you speak of history as such, among some people who have spoken of the sequence in these terms have been at least two thinkers I can think of. There are many others, I'm just mentioning two. One of them died recently, Gay Lambert, but also Christophe Jaffelot. And both of them have pointed out that actually the counter-revolutionary violence, the counter-revolutionary sort of blindness came out of something which was not an ideological threat purely. It was not a threat of vision that you have an Ambedkarite vision, which could be Buddhist, Dalit, and they are not the same, we'll come to that in a moment, but basically an Ambedkarite vision of social revolution, to which the old Hindu hierarchical Sanatani reaction set in with that kind of force. There was something else that happened, and we know what that is. Exactly around that time, between 1989 and 1992 with the V.P. Singh government, and that is the Mandal Commission. The implementation of the Mandal Commission recommendations. That was the material circumstance in which the counter-revolution took its most violent, its most sort of insistent shape. Why? I'm not going to analyze Mandal Commission here, but we need to get at the essence of what is at stake in this question of Mandal Commission. And this is something Gail Ombed pointed out in a very, very insightful way. She said that with Mandal Commission, what came out very clearly was another aspect of the Ambedkarite history from, let's say, Ambedkar's death to now. And that is not simply the idea or the vision of emancipation, the idea or the vision of social change, but something which is power, a redistribution, an intervention, a contestation over state power, political power, governmental power. So Mandal Commission was, in a way, through society, through education, through institutions, which clearly were deeply dominated by structures of Brahmanical hegemony, Brahmanical, you know, Varchaswa. Reservation, backward caste reservation, was in a way, in a very contested way, complicated way, a continuation of the reservation policy as affirmative action for the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, but in a way that was far more dominantly a question of reconfiguring, redistributing the very center of political power in India. So in that sense, the upper caste constituency who were in power, whether through Congress or through other parties, as a social constituency, felt the immediate threat. The immediate threat which is expressed in a political way. Even if it was subjectively lived out, particularly in the anti-Mandals, and I was part of that generation which saw the anti-Mandal, you know, literally fire burning on the streets of Delhi. So that was subjective, and that had a real passion. But that passion was only a mask for something very objective, and that objective was the danger, the threat to mainstream state power, which hitherto, till then, by and large, upper caste Hindu social constituents had monopolized. Now, it was not, so the point is, and Ombed pointed this out, it was not as if this was directly translated to the idea of the emancipation of the Dalits, of the oppressed, of those who were at the lowest and the most deprived part of society, whether that be the question of social dignity, whether that be education, and of course that be political power. It was not a direct overhauling of that now, like, you know, the idea of Lenin, for instance, was that proletariat would take power after the revolution. You know, take power, literally take it. And in that sense, logically, he said, there would be for some time a dictatorship, not democracy, not equality, but the opposite of the earlier inequality, a kind of proletariat inequality. This was not that. This was, through the Mandal Commission, and only an indicator, mind you, but a very strong indicator, not of an overhauling, not of the coincidence of the idea of a Dalit or a proletariat takeover which coincides with the actual, you know, people who have come into power. No, of course not. Even today, the actual section of Dalits who exercise power in the state is a very small number, a very small magnitude. But with the backward caste, what is called the Shudra configuration, there became a kind of intermediate region where a lot of recalibration was now starting to take place, which, as a possible future, would be a very, very detrimental and unstable future for the settled upper caste domination. So in that sense, in a very uncertain way, that Mandal Commission moment actually became a threshold for a certain kind of how should one put it, a certain kind of counter-revolutionary emergency, a kind of Hindu sense of emergency. So before we experience the emergency that today, which I call a communal emergency, I've written about it, today there's a communal emergency in this country. But actually, if you look at it in terms of the last 30 years in that sequence, then you'll find that the Hindus, through the Mandal Commission movement, not Hindus in the empirical sense, not all Hindus, that is a different thing. The subject, the historical form, which is a form of power called Hindu power, as a social power, experienced a kind of emergency at that time. And exactly like in an emergency you react, they reacted. Not reacted in the simply in the impulsive sense, but reacted in a strategic way, but also with a tremendous amount of force and violence, which was very, very strange. What did they do? They did not immediately take on the entire range of new social movements, whether that be seen through the Ambedkarite perspective or, you know, a combination of perspectives. In the south of India, you have Periyar, you have even before that, you have Yothidas and all kinds of different social revolutionary movements, including Buddha. No, they didn't do that. What the upper caste constituency did was, they actually appropriated the largest ideological polarization that in modern Indian history you could revive. And that was clearly the polarization between Hindu and Muslim. Because in a way, Muslim was not simply Muslim. Muslim was also a kind of covering term, you know, like a joker in the pack, which you can use for playing any card. So when you say Muslim, it is Muslim. And then you can, through a kind of slippage, slip that into every other kind of minority. Because of the rhetorical reason that Muslims, through the partition and even before that, are already seen as if they are the opposite, the other of the Hindu. In an unreal, spectral sense, banavati, lekin banavati ka bhi asar asli. So in that sense, the specific conjuncture where Rajiv Gandhi opened the gates and all of that led to a very specific strategic reaction, but a reaction to the larger Ambedkarite revolutionary possibility of change in society. And that was the sort of threshold of something like Babri Masjid happening in 1992, coincidentally on 6th December. Now, of course, this is not an exhaustive explanation. Some of it can be argued and demonstrated factually, like I'm trying to indicate. Some people have done it. But this is a possible way of thinking about it in the present. I'm not speaking as a historian. I'm speaking as someone who is trying to make sense of our present historical realities and archives, documents. That's all. Okay? Anyway, if you have this picture, then you will get another dimension, you know, coming to you, which is the place, the site where this polarization that the Babri Masjid, in a way, you know, illustrated. Ki masjid todna hai, masjid par dhawa bolna hai. To ek bahut hi thos architectural sawal paida hoti hai. जो लोग तोड़ रहे हैं उनके लिए मस्जिद क्या है, क्या है वो जगह जहाँ पे वो जा रहे हैं? और वो फोटोग्राफ सबने देखी हैं। मुझे याद है मैं जेएनयू में पढ़ता था उस समय, और मैं छत्तीसगढ़ से, उस समय मध्य प्रदेश था, मैं लौट रहा था जेएनयू, मतलब दिल्ली, और ट्रेन कैंसिल होनी शुरू हुई बीच में, क्योंकि कर्फ्यू लग रहे थे और ट्रेन कैंसिल हो गई थी। नागपुर पर, भोपाल पर, अलग अलग जगह ट्रेन कैंसिल हो गई थी। लेकिन मैं पहुँचा फिर भी दिल्ली 3.5 दिन बाद। तो ये सब हो रहा था, रियल डिसोरिएंटेशंस वर टेकिंग प्लेस, एटलीस्ट इन द नॉर्दर्न पार्ट, नॉर्थ सेंट्रल पार्ट ऑफ इंडिया। और लेकिन सब कुछ के सेंटर था एक कॉन्सेंट्रेटेड एक्शन एट दैट अयोध्या टाउन, बाबरी मस्जिद, अ काइंड ऑफ फिजिकल कॉन्सेंट्रेशन। नहीं, उसकी फोटोग्राफ्स आज तक हम उसके वो देखते हैं। तो क्या था वो, क्या उससे क्या साइट क्या दिख रहा था? क्लियरली वो एक बहुत ही, और उसका इंडिकेटर आज भी मिल रहा है। So I'm going to, because I don't have much time, I'm going to jump about a little bit. वो एक चीज थी जो आज आपको बहुत ही छोटे पैमाने पर लेकिन बहुत ही ज्यादा परेशानी पैदा करने करती है, जो आप देखते हैं गुड़गांव में हो रहा है आजकल, हर शुक्रवार को गुड़गांव में हो रहा है, नहीं कि नमाज के दौरान पीपल आर कमिंग इन, नमाज के दौरान समथिंग इज गोइंग ऑन, नमाज के दौरान भजन इज बीइंग प्लेड, समथिंग इज समथिंग. Now, how does one, I mean, the obvious problem is there, but how does one actually think about it? That is the question. It seems to me that one way to think about, again, this can't be proved. These are ideas that I'm putting before you. One way to think about it is, ki while I'm doing this at Babri Masjid, we did it. I mean, we, of course, I speak on behalf of someone I would rather not speak of, but still I'm using this we term in the most open sense. We did it because it was thought to be as if Indian history ka ek kind of, you know, judgment day. Aur abhi Gurgaon mein ho raha hai as a very little petty corner of the space of Indian territory. Lekin same cheez is at stake, which is ki there has to be a disappearing of the so-called congregation that is other than Hindu, whether it's Muslim, Christians ke saath bhi ho raha hai, Karnatak mein. We have to disappear, make disappear. We have to completely void out this space, this architectural space, jahan ek aur congregation hai, jise hum Muslim keh rahe hain ya Christian keh rahe hain, kuch aur keh rahe hain. And masjid stands for that kind of a congregation. Now see, there is an irony here, something really peculiar here. The Babri Masjid was just one masjid, or is one masjid among many masjids. It is a place of prayer among many places of prayer. But because on the site of Babri Masjid, the polarization is between the image of a mosque on the one side, among other mosques, but on the other side, on the other pole is what? Birthplace of Ram. The God, it becomes a total picture. The total picture of one people against another people. But that is the image. That is the kind of you know, the so-called, well, I don't know if you want to call it myth or not, but definitely a certain kind of an imagination that you create in your minds. Okay, all of Hindu people concentrated in one place where you are worshipping Ram, the birthplace of Ram. But precisely because Babri Masjid is there, then it seems Babri Masjid stands for all of the congregation of what you call Muslim. Now this is clearly a delusion. This is clearly, something is terribly wrong with this crazy imagination. But it is to me a very real imagination that in a very petty localized way operates in little corners in our country. Again and again, कि जहां पर भी जाकर डिस्टर्ब हो रहा है, आप वहां नहीं करेंगे, हम यहां भजन गाएंगे, हम यहां स्लोगन्स बोलेंगे, जय श्री राम बोलेंगे वगैरह. इट इज नॉट सिंपली दैट कॉर्नर. द स्टेट सेड कि ऑल ऑफ द अदर्स आर हियर, ऑल ऑफ हिंदुइज्म एंड द हिंदू पीपल विच इज इक्वल टू इंडियन पीपल एंड सो ऑन सो फोर्थ, ऑल ऑफ इज एट स्टेक. और बाबरी मस्जिद में इट सीम्स समथिंग लाइक दिस was the what Umvet and Chris Jaffelot in a kind of Ambedkarite light called the counter-revolutionary reaction, where as if all of the possibility of change in society had to be opposed in terms of a kind of Sanatani counter-revolutionary ki yahi hai aur yahan par hum sab ikattha hai, you know. But interestingly, it was not done directly with, I mean, of course, the atrocities against Dalits is a story that continues every day. But at the level of this kind of political mobilization, it happened against Muslims. And it's still happening against Muslims. That is very interesting and very disturbing. Because it seems to me, the sense of communal emergency that the Hindus felt with, again, Hindus, you shouldn't misunderstand. I don't mean Hindus literally born Hindu X, Y, Z. I mean Hindus as this form. This historical form of power. that communal emergency that they felt as a community with the Mandal Commission could only be mirrored in inducing another communal emergency, which today is being felt by Muslims. I don't think anyone can contest that across the board in our country. So it is a long process, but it has a, to me, a very clear historical causal field. Now, of course, this has nothing to do with Ambedkar or Ambedkar's death in 1956, because it happened after his death. But it has something to do at another level, you know? And I want to talk about that a little bit before ending. And that is the question of religion. After all, when this Hindu-Muslim polarization is created, and this image or imaginary of a total, you know, economics mein hota na, zero-sum game. Ki agar ek badhega to dusra ghatega hi. Ek jiyega to dusra marega. Ek hoga to dusre ko nahi hona. Ye jo zero-sum game imposed hai, is tarah ki imagination mein hamare yahan aajkal, agar Hindu hai to Muslim nahi hoga. Vagaira, vagaira. Ye zero-sum game रिलीजन के टर्म्स में वर्क करता है सबसे ज्यादा क्यों, या रिलीजन के टर्म्स में वर्क करवाने की कोशिश चल रही है, और उसमें 1956 में अगर वापस जाएं, रिमेंबरिंग कि वन थिंग हैज नथिंग टू डू विद द अदर इन टर्म्स ऑफ कॉजल लॉजिक, इन टर्म्स ऑफ रैशनल थिंकिंग, बट इन टर्म्स ऑफ कॉन्सेप्ट्स समथिंग इज एट स्टेक व्हिच सीम्स टू मी टू बी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड इज वर्थ डिस्कसिंग, एंड दैट इज the question of religion, because as we know, at the last stage of Ambedkar's life, Ambedkar was someone who not only spoke of religion in a very serious way, he also converted very clearly to a so-called religion, which is Buddhism, you know, and he wrote copiously, and that's why even his life ending in his death should be taken very seriously. Why? Because at that time, from 1952 at least to 1956, Ambedkar was spending all his energies, all his vitality, physically jo hai insaan ka, or mental, intellectual vitality, on writing. On writing. He wrote, he was always writing, but this at this point he was writing extraordinarily voluminously. तो एक स्टोरी है, उनके सेक्रेटरी बोल रहे हैं वो रात को जब निकले उनके घर से दिल्ली में अंबेडकर के बाबा साहब के घर से, तो देखा कि ऐसे कोने में टेबल पर लिख रहे हैं वो, और जब लौटे अगले दिन सुबह तब भी उसी पोजीशन में लिख रहे थे वो सारी रात. क्या लिख रहे थे वो? बुद्ध एंड हिज धम्म, वो लिख रहे थे. नाउ दिस इज अ पैशन, दिस इज नॉट लाइफ इन मेयरली द नेचुरल सेंस. This is indeed a passion, जिसको हम books कहते हैं, libraries में पढ़ते हैं, हमारी you know पूरी academic credentials, कितनी किताबों का ढेर बनता है उससे बनता है, लेकिन actually वो passion अम्बेडकर की आखिरी जिंदगी के आखिरी पड़ाव में हमें इस तरह से दिखता है, और उसके testimonies हैं, stories हैं. लेकिन क्या वो passion in that sense सिर्फ academic था? ना, पढ़ाई तो वो हर सारी जिंदगी करते रहे, हर चीज पढ़े थे, लेकिन ये स्पेसिफिक चीज थी, विजन. वो विजन क्या था? दैट इज अ क्वेश्चन यू नीड टू आस्क वेरी ब्रीफली. काम तो बहुत बड़ा था, लेकिन मैं ब्रीफली बोलूंगा. टू मी दैट विजन वॉज इंटरनेशनलिस्ट, एंड द वे टू थिंक अबाउट दैट वॉज अगेन इंडिकेटेड बाय हिम इन वन ऑफ हिज स्पीचेस दैट ही गेव 15 डेज बिफोर ही डाइड इन काठमांडू at a World Buddhist Conference, where he compared Buddhism with communism. Not to say Buddhism and communism are doing the same things, they are, you know, together, let's build an alliance. No, he did it with a rigorous sense of rivalry. What kind of rivalry? A kind of methodological rivalry, but also a kind of subjective rivalry with a rival who has the common objective aim. That was the interesting thing about this speech. He says, objectively, communism wants to achieve the same thing that Buddhism does, which is equality. But subjectively, there is a rivalry. So in my speech, I'm going to now talk about why I think, as the rival of communism, subjectively, Buddhism is better. And I'm doing this, Ambedkar said, by addressing the young people of the world. He's not saying India, he's not even saying, in that sense, the oppressed classes in India. He's saying the youths of the world, particularly the Buddhist world. Because he's saying something very interesting. He's saying at that time, 56, Yadrako, 56, he's saying a lot of the youth are reading communism. They're influenced by communism. And he's saying, I'm going to now challenge you to a subjective test. Both have the same aim, but our methods are different. Not our methods, but our subjective ways are different. And I'm going to challenge you to show me why communism is better than Buddhism. And so on and so forth it goes. This to me is an internationalist passion, which is both speaking but also writing down in a text like Buddhayana Dhamma. And one of the main sort of zones in which this passion is being sort of fought out, and Ambedkar is a fighting author. He is speaking, saying the most beautiful things, but at the same time he's fighting the ones he needs to fight, or he thinks he needs to fight. Both things he's doing together. But in books, always in books. So he's burning the Manusmriti in 1927 and reading the Manusmriti while burning it. This is the thing. Burning is not to read. To read and to burn. To burn and to read. Never ending, this has to go on. You know? If it has to be a kind of reaction to Manusmriti. If, as an example. Anyway. So this passion we can see in 1956. At the very end. But again, when you read now, after so much water has flown and so much blood has flown literally under the bridge, what is it that we read in Buddha and his Dhamma? We read something really, really strange, which is not really part of Buddhism or Buddha's teachings, which is also not part of communism. Why? Because communism has said, Marx himself has said, having done one of the smartest analysis of religion in the Jewish question in 1844, smartest writing on the question of religion. But it has basically said, religion is mystification, religion is ideology. All religion is ideology. Ambedkar is saying something very different, no? Ambedkar is saying, between religions we must evaluate. Between religions we must find the measure of evaluating according to principles, which to adopt, which to reject. Which to adopt in what way, up to what point, a calibration of religion in our lives, in our thinking, in our choices. He's not saying religion is mystification all in all. He's saying, yes, some religions are mystification. In the worst sense, for instance, he says Hinduism. It's mystification in the worst sense. But he also says, yet we must open ourselves to the possibility of rational religion. Now, this is something communism and Marxism clearly opposes. The jury is out on these things. I'm not saying who's right, who's wrong. That's not my job. But I'm saying this question was concretely opened up by Ambedkar in 1956. Question of religion as a site, document, thinking, practice of rational beings. So you'll find something really extraordinary, which I discovered some time back when I spoke at Naglok in Nagpur, when I was reading Buddhayana Dhamma again. And Ambedkar is doing this, the test of religion. He says that we have to see which religion is open to principles. Principles of equality, principles of fraternity, principles of freedom. But the principles in themselves are not religious. The principles are the creation of human capacity. So you see, he has actually found a rational, egalitarian, even communistic measure for something which is essentially opposed to communism, which is thinking about religion. According to the principles which are human creations, not religious creations. If religion is to be thought of coming from a book, coming from God, coming from revelation. You know, this is extraordinary. And then he says, and it is rational, it is a rational possibility that each of us is able to make his or her choice according to this test. Which religion is compatible and espouses principles, which are these fundamental principles of constitution, of course, but this is not just limited to constitution. It is universal in the fundamental generic sense, universal sense, in the human sense. And then it says, and in effect, this is what happens. Even Buddhism is subject to this investigation. So you see, something paradoxical has happened, which no religious writer would do. No writer of the Gita, no writer of Quran, no writer of the Bible, if you can think of writers in this sense, of course, would say, ki, I'm opening a test for religion to which the religion in question itself is subject. It would be at the most said that, look, our religion has the broad-mindedness of, you know, having a rational attitude to religion. But to say that rational attitude applies to that religion itself is, I mean, it's something which bewilders the mind. But this is what Ambedkar does in Buddha and His Dhamma. A lot of Buddha and His Dhamma is problematic for many people, and rightly so. But the fundamental test remains absolutely clear, that every religion is subject to rational evaluation, including Buddhism. And that becomes so true, you know, without Ambedkar having foreseen it, when you see that Ambedkar actually was getting into a very risky internationalist political territory, which was, he was campaigning basically for Buddhist power, just like he wanted Dalit power in the state, he also wanted Buddhist power at an international hegemony, at a level of international hegemony. Because communism and the Western countries, liberal countries, were the two hegemonic poles. And he was campaigning for, at least in Asia, but ideally all over the world, a Buddhist hegemony. But hegemony has to deal with power. No, you can't help it. With structures of power, institutions of power. And since Ambedkar died, the experience of religion entering power has not been good at all, anywhere. So Buddhism has turned out to be really dismal, if not horrible, horrific, in examples like Burma, now that has nothing to do with Buddhism, you could say, and rightly so, but it doesn't matter. It is the question of Buddhist hegemony, just like any other Hindu hegemony, any other religious hegemony. Now, Ambedkar, of course, did not actually enter into this picture because it happened after his death. But the point is, he took a risk there, but a massive risk. Why? Not for the sake of power. Because it was an unreal situation. It's sitting in India, going to Kathmandu to think of international Buddhist hegemony was unreal. But he was still campaigning for it as a vision, as a vision. So there was a very interesting contradiction in Ambedkar towards the last part of his life, a minor contradiction. And yet a minor contradiction with major consequences, which was a contradiction between, on the one hand, and this was, he shared this with Lenin, on the one hand, deep interest in state power. Deep interest in state power. Just like Lenin, he was a great leader, great revolutionary, but always interested in state power, mechanisms of state power. So was Ambedkar, we all know it. But at the same time, vision in the truest sense, which is internationalist and always beyond the limited stakes of state power. So there was a contradiction. And it is a contradiction shared by the greatest figures of political thought. Ambedkar also partook of this contradiction towards the end of his life. But what is what we see, and that is the question with which I would like to end today, is that between Babri Masjid and the present, that question of religion has come back with a tremendous amount of vehemence. Where religion has both facilitated this kind of imagination of complete, like I said, complete congregation, assembly, people coming together as a single monolith, where you will fear the discipline of an international Islamism, international Christianity, and then in some corner in Gujarat, sorry, in Gujarat of course, but in Gurgaon I meant to say, and of course in what you did in Babri Masjid. Yeah. The truth always speaks. Yeah. And you did it in Babri Masjid. You do it for the sake of this spectral assembly of the others together. But you can't do it at the level you fear it. That is my point, you see. You fear it at the level of power, politics, real worldly contest over what we fight over, ki kaun state chalayega, kis tarah kiska varchasva hoga. You actually are bothered with that, but you present it as religion. Kyunki religion wo schema aapko bana banaya de raha hai. वहां पर वापस मार्क्स का या कम्युनिज्म का सवाल पैदा हो जाता है कि क्या कुछ रिलीजन को लेकर एसेंशियल दिक्कत है जिसके बारे में इस बीच सोचना करीब करीब वो हो गया था, घट गया था या खत्म ही हो गया था, अब वापस लाने की जरूरत है बिना कम्युनिज्म या मार्क्सिज्म का पुराने सॉर्ट ऑफ वो रहे उस तरह की उनके खुद के वर्चस्व के बिना. ये एक सवाल है. लेकिन दूसरी तरफ दूसरा सवाल भी है. नहीं, अगर अंबेडकर के नजरिए से सोचो तो क्या प्रॉब्लम यह है कि हमारी रैशनल कैपेसिटीज की रिलीजन का सवाल सिर्फ नहीं है, हमारी रैशनल कैपेसिटीज पर कुछ एक मेजर हमला हुआ है, या हम खुद अपनी रैशनल कैपेसिटीज को इतना खो बैठे हैं कि किसी के साथ हम वो रैशनल एंगेजमेंट नहीं कर सकते, इंक्लूडिंग रिलीजन, जिससे ये आज हिंदू काउंटर रेवोल्यूशन मुस्लिम को इस तरह का एक स्पेक्ट्रल जिससे डर भी लगता है, एक इस्लामिक स्पेक्टर ऑफ सारी दुनिया में इस्लामिक एक है, एंड एट द सेम टाइम आप उसको जेनोसाइडली उसको गायब करना चाहते हो, चाहे वो एक छोटे से मस्जिद में हो चाहे और तरीके. तो ये क्या कहां पे हमें या दोनों पे करना है, रिलीजन पे भी, लेकिन अंबेडकर की वो पुरानी बात भी वापस लानी है कि रिलीजन का भी एक इवेल्युएशन करते रहना है रादर देन पूरा का पूरा रिलीजन को मिस्टिफिकेशन या आइडियोलॉजी कह के वो कर देना, खारिज कर देना. मुझे नहीं पता, पर मुझे लगता है ये सवाल पूछना आज जरूरी है, क्योंकि लिबरल सर्कल्स में दिक्कत है. इस तरह का एंटी रिलीजन होना वुड बी पागल होना, इडियोसिंक्रेटिक होना, और रिलीजन को मान लेना लिबरल तरीके से कि सब रिलीजन अच्छे होते हैं, पर इट डजंट वर्क आउट. नो, इट सिंपली डजंट वर्क आउट लाइक दैट इन रियलिटी. नॉट बिकॉज रिलीजन अच्छे होते हैं बुरे होते हैं, इसलिए कि रिलीजियंस हिस्टोरिकली अलग अलग डायमेंशंस लाते हैं. सो फॉर इंस्टेंस, बाबरी मस्जिद के बाद मुस्लिम एक मॉडर्न एंटिटी है. क्यों? क्योंकि बाबरी मस्जिद के बाद जो इंडियन मुस्लिम हम कहते हैं वो पोस्ट बाबरी मस्जिद एक फिगर है जो मॉडर्न हिस्ट्री का एक ब्रेक है. वो किसी एक जगह की उपज नहीं है, चाहे वो सावरकर ने कहा था कि पुण्य भूमि हिंदुओं की यहां है, मुसलमानों की कहीं और है, क्रिश्चियंस की कहीं और है. ना, ये पुण्य भूमि का सवाल नहीं है. ये सवाल है जो जहां है वहीं का है, लेकिन जहां है वहीं का तो है, लेकिन वहां पे दरार पैदा हुई है. तो अब दरार से पैदा हुए हैं, और दरार से पैदा होना होता है आधुनिकता. इन दैट सेंस मुस्लिम इज मॉडर्न. बट स्ट्रेंजली सीए के खिलाफ जो मुहिम छिड़ी है, और 2 साल पहले जिसका इतना एकदम हमारे साथ था, वो उसमें ये बात बहुत सामने आई थी कि मुस्लिम के नाम पर बोलना है, लेकिन मुस्लिम आज की रियलिटी है, मॉडर्न रियलिटी. एग्जैक्टली इसके ऑपोजिट ये काउंटर रेवोल्यूशनरी हिंदू फॉर्म जो क्रिएट किया गया है वो कहता है बार बार कि नहीं, हम हिस्ट्री के बियॉन्ड हैं, नहीं हम राम टेम्पल की जगह पर पैदा हैं या राम से जुड़े हुए हैं, और वो जगह हिस्टोरिकल नहीं है. तो लिटरली जो मेटाफर है ना आर्कियोलॉजी का, अलग अलग लेयर्स जिसको आप वो करते हो, उसको आर्कियोलॉजिस्ट उसको निकालते हैं उस लेयर्स को, टू फाइंड कि पास्ट में क्या क्या था, है ना. उसी से तो ये पूरा अयोध्या का जजमेंट बना है ना. पूरा जजमेंट तो वहीं से आया कि ये लेयर से निकालने से हमें कोई टेम्पल मिलता है, इसी पर तो जजमेंट खड़ा है. नहीं, लेकिन एक्चुअली आइडियोलॉजी या उसकी जो स्पेक्टर है, उसका जो एक पूरा उसका जो एक पूरा उसकी जो प्रेतात्मा खड़ी की गई है इंडियन हिस्ट्री के पूरे बैकड्रॉप पर, वो प्रेतात्मा ये है कि ऐसा कोई लेयर नहीं है, एक पार्ट चीज है वो हिंदू, और वो एक पॉइंट है जन्मभूमि जिस पे टेंपल वगैरह. तो यहां पे मॉडर्न का सेंस बाबरी मस्जिद के साथ जन्म होना, और जिन लोगों ने बाबरी मस्जिद की वजह पैदा की उनका कहना कि कोई मॉडर्न नहीं होता, मुस्लिम भी आगे मतलब पिछले जन्म का है, और पिछले जन्म में सिर्फ बर्बरता की है, और हिंदू तो उससे भी आगे का है. एंड सो इट गोज, इट्स अ जीरो सम गेम इन टाइम ऑल्सो. यू नो, दिस काइंड ऑफ क्रेजीनेस is something we are living with in reality, it seems to me. So it seems to me कि हम जितना भी कह लें कि सब कुछ एसेंशियली सब धर्म अच्छे होते हैं, जो हो सकता होते हैं, हो सकता नहीं होते, मुझे नहीं पता उसके बारे में, मुझे नहीं पता. लेकिन इन रियलिटी हिस्टोरिकली, मैं सिर्फ क्योंकि हिस्ट्री के टर्म्स में बात कर रहा हूं, पिछले 40-50 साल के लेवल पे हमारी हमारा एक्सपीरियंस ऐसा नहीं है. तो अगर कोई ये कहे कि ना मुझे एक्स रिलीजन बेहतर लगता है, वाई रिलीजन, यू कांट ब्लेम दैट पर्सन अगर रिलीजन के टर्म्स में कहना हो तो. लेकिन इंटरेस्टिंग ये है कि अगर आप मुस्लिम कहोगे तो मॉडर्न सेंस में कहना पड़ेगा, पोस्ट बाबरी मस्जिद, अ काइंड ऑफ मुस्लिम विथ अ ब्रेक. लेकिन एलिगेशन ये है कि मुस्लिम, शर्जील इमाम को सबसे ज्यादा इस एलिगेशन में फंसाया वाला लाया गया है कि मुस्लिम एज इफ बियॉन्ड मॉडर्निटी बात करता है, मुस्लिम किस कुछ अपनी दुनिया में रहता है, मॉडर्न उससे जुड़ा नहीं है, समाज से जुड़ा नहीं है, इंडिया से जुड़ा नहीं है. लेकिन एक्चुअली थ्रू एनालिसिस ऑफ बाबरी मस्जिद व्हाट वी सी इज द ऑपोजिट, दैट जिन्होंने वो पोलराइजेशन पैदा किया वो अब कह रहे हैं कि ऐसा कोई पोल है ही नहीं. इसका मतलब क्या है, इसका मतलब क्या है? द काउंटर रेवोल्यूशन सेज कि बाबरी मस्जिद हुआ ही नहीं था, ऐसी कोई चीज हुई नहीं थी. 1992 6 दिसंबर डज नॉट एग्जिस्ट. अंबेडकर 6 दिसंबर मान लेंगे क्योंकि पीछे था, सेफ है, लेकिन 6 दिसंबर इज टू रियल टू एक्सेप्ट. सो वो कहेगा कि 6 दिसंबर 1992 डज नॉट एग्जिस्ट, यू नो. बट टू से 6 दिसंबर एग्जिस्ट is not to say कि 6 December 1992 is some sort of a, you know, some kind of a clarion call to some opposite massive mobilization that will take that takes place at the level of some sort of alternative liberal utopia. I don't think that works. According to me, and the last thing I want to say, the 6th December is a specific, 1992 is a specific historical division through which a strange kind of modernity comes into the picture, for which one of the names could be a Muslim modernity. But that Muslim modernity is not necessarily a religious name only. But it is searching for something which is an acceptable universal human name. That definitely. So when people say citizen at anti-CA protest, citizen, we are citizens, then they are not simply saying citizen. They are searching for a name which has an amplitude beyond a specific religious name, which could be citizen. But even citizen is not satisfactory because citizen is also exclusionary. So then you search for something. You keep searching for something. You know, then you search for something which at some point the Marxists said proletariat. In the Dalit movement, you said Dalit. But at every moment, it is a historical search. It is a specific search. It is a search here and now with us. So those of us who speak in the name of Muslim will search for that other name. Those of us who don't have to speak in the name of Muslim are actually meant to exchange our names with the so-called others, the minorities. Clearly, we can't exchange the name Hindu for Muslim. That's not going to work. You know? So, I mean, what will that name be? I do not know today. I don't think I can be romantic and say we can say revolutionary. We can say, you know, even to say Buddhist, somehow, it's too romantic, it's too easy. So let me end with saying that today in this meeting, let us join hands, let us join voices, and let us join ourselves in a kind of what Ambedkar called Maitri, in a spirit of Maitri, in search of the new name. Thank you. So if you have any questions, any points, I'll be very happy to talk to you. Yeah.
My question is also regarding history.
Yeah.
I've just come in mind the Ambedkar's famous distinction between rural and plains.
Yeah.
Say that Hinduism is a religion of
Buddhism. Yeah.
Buddhism is comprehensible.
Yeah.
So, if I'm correct, you said that the historical religion of Buddhism ended with the conversion of the Baba Saheb Ambedkar. So, I think it's a teleological end on the basis of time. Do you think that it was an end on the basis of principle, or Ambedkar was just practicing a perspective or hermeneutics of the historical religion of the Buddhism?
Okay. Very, very interesting question, Dheeraj. It's a complex question. What Dheeraj is asking is, was Ambedkar converting to Buddhism, and not only Ambedkar, with Ambedkar, lakhs of people, converting to Buddhism as a part of a kind of inheriting a text, a set of traces, texts, documents of Buddhism, or was it something which was a kind of historical, practical moment? Conversion. So that is, of course, I spoke about it, which was the paradoxical nature of his own book, the Buddha and His Dhamma. So Buddha and His Dhamma is a unique book where you convert to the book you yourself write. Of course, that is not a willful book. It is not ki apna kuch bhi Buddhism ke naam pe bana diya. Nahin, Ambedkar wrote a book about Buddhism, and yet it is not a book which coincides with the history of Buddhism, the historical Buddhism. In that sense, you could call it an artistic Buddhism. Again, artistic not to be understood as self-indulgence, but artistic in the strict sense of creativity. And it is exactly artistic insofar as Buddha and His Dhamma is a literary work, in the sense of literature. But it was not simply a work of literature meant for, you know, an open-ended range of historical readers. It was also meant for the people there and then. Just like I am speaking to you here and now, similarly, there and then people were speaking to each other, including Ambedkar himself. In that sense, they were saying, we have written the book and we must convert to it. But the book is what? The book is exactly what Dheeraj points out, a book of principles. In the main, of course, the book has many stories, many legends, many inherited fables, much of which is very problematic. I'm not going to talk about that today. But one has to read, so no one must stop reading, ever. Lekin, in the main, that book is a book of principles. But the principles are not simply embedded in stories, like Buddha's principles are embedded in Buddha's actions, in his moral, in his lessons. In Ambedkar, to that extent, he's a philosopher, in the strict sense, he actually enunciates those principles. So parts of Buddha and His Dhamma are extraordinary, no? Buddha is speaking to Marx in that book, in a dramaturgy, dramaturgy of thinkers in a place which is not a historical place, which is a heaven without any theological, because Ambedkar didn't believe in any theology of heaven. And yet, in that book, Ambedkar is speaking, Ambedkar is there, of course, but Buddha is speaking with Marx. Like two, you know, theater mein hota hai na, do character, ek dusre ke saath discuss kar raha hai. ये तो है उस बुक में है लेकिन क्या वो सिर्फ एक खेल है मजेदार खेल है ना इट इज ऑल मेंट फॉर एन इंटरवेंशन व्हिच इज दैट ऑफ कन्वर्शन मैस कन्वर्शन बट मैस कन्वर्शन नॉट सिंपली एट द सब्जेक्टिव लेवल कि करना है कन्वर्ट वो तो करना ही है लेकिन बेस्ड ऑन इवैल्यूएशन ऑफ बुद्धिज्म एज इनन्सिएटिंग दीज प्रिंसिपल्स व्हिच ऑफ कोर्स अंबेडकर आल्सो आइडेंटिफाइड विद द प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ द फ्रेंच रेवोल्यूशन Not to think of French Revolution as the Western sort of, you know, liberal colonial model which Ambedkar was influenced by, but as another site at a very different part of the world where the same principles were again universally acknowledged by a particular people, the French people there. In the same way that Phule spoke of, if you remember, Bali Raja. He said Bali Raja and Christ can be compared. Not because Bali Raja is derived from Christ or Christ from Bali Raja, but because both have a universal capacity, or they contain a universal address, amplitude, capacity, in that way. But ye sab ho sakta hai agar historically, us moment pe, October 1956, you take that step of converting, which he did. So yeah, that's my answer. Yeah, sure.
When Babri Masjid was demolished,
yeah.
I think even the parliamentary left they created a division between Hinduism and Hindutva.
बिल्कुल ये सब हुआ.
And I am referring to Kafi Azmi's poem also, Ram
Vanvas. Yeah, बिल्कुल बिल्कुल बिल्कुल.
The same current continues. We have seen recently some seminars being held on Hindutva, and again the liberals are talking about Hindutva is one thing, Hinduism is another thing. Hinduism is all about faith, which 80 crores and more than Hindus profess, and it is all about diversity. There is no fixed definition, but Hindutva is very much political agenda. When we read Ambedkar, we don't find any such division in him, because from in a lesson of caste onwards, you will see how the caste has been analyzed from the point of view of Hindu scripture. Now I am asking you this question. You have engaged with Ambedkar's writing, and also you are looking at liberals' politics also. Can we differentiate? I'm asking this question. Can we differentiate Hinduism from Hindutva?
अरे ये तो पढ़ना पड़ता है. अंबेडकर ऑफ कोर्स यू आर राइट एंड यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट. मतलब मैंने खुद बोला अभी कि लिबरल एक है कि सब रिलीजन्स अच्छे हैं, उसके अंदर फर्क करना है. ना बट इसमें कुछ और बात है. उसके लिए अंबेडकर तो पढ़ना ही पढ़ना है, पर सावरकर पढ़ो. मैं पढ़ा ही होगा, मुझसे ज़्यादा पढ़ा होगा आप लोगों ने. मैं कह रहा हूँ बस जो मैंने पढ़ा वो मैं आपसे नोट्स कंपेयर कर रहा हूँ. सावरकर वॉज द वन हु एक्चुअली created these concepts of three concepts. He was the first one, to my knowledge, in Indian history. Hindutva, Hinduism, Hindudam. Pahli baar, Savarkar mein ye teen concepts aate hain. Usse pehle, jise hum Hinduism kehte hain, wo raha hai. Khaskar, Orientalist colonial literature mein toh bahut raha hai. Hindudam aur Hindutva relatively nye words the. Hai na? Toh Savarkar kya bolte hain? What is Savarkar saying? When he is actually saying तीन चीजें हैं जिस फ्रंट पे हमें काम करना है, और अम्बेडकर ने इसके बारे में थॉट्स इन पाकिस्तान में लिखा है, बहुत ही क्लोज एनालिसिस है इन चीजों की. तो वेरी अगेन वेरी, अब तो टाइम नहीं इतना, ब्रीफली बोलूंगा मैं. पहली बात तो यह है कि अगर सावरकर से शुरू करते हैं पढ़ते हुए, तो सावरकर कह रहे हैं कि ये एक प्रोजेक्ट है. किस चीज के लिए? पॉलिटिकल हिंदूज के लिए. तो सावरकर के आसपास कई लोग हैं जो रिलीजन के लेवल पे हिंदूज़म को, कि रिलीजन के लेवल पे हिंदू को और वो बनाना है, सशक्त बनाना है, वर्चस्व बढ़ाना है. क्रिश्चियनिटी की वजह से इतना वो हो रहा है, इतना नुकसान हो रहा है हिंदुओं को, वगैरह वगैरह. सावरकर रिलेटिवली इम्पेशेंट है इन चीज़ों से. वो रिलेटिवली, उनको धीरज नहीं है, सॉरी धीरज. उनको इन चीज़ों से उतना वो नहीं. वो कह रहे हैं ना मेन प्रोजेक्ट है पॉलिटिकल है. मैंने ये बात पहले कही है कि रिलीजन एक स्पेक्टर कह सकते हो, एक रैशनल स्कीम कह सकते हो, जो भी कहो, लेकिन एक और चीज है, वो है पॉलिटिकल पावर. वो है बॉडीज ऑफ अदर्स पे अपना वर्चस्व, अपना कंट्रोल, उनको मॉडिफाई करना, उनसे काम करवाना, वगैरह वगैरह, कलेक्टिव लेवल पे, पब्लिक लेवल पे. सावरकर का मेन इंटरेस्ट है कि कैसे हिंदूज दूसरों पर अपना वर्चस्व, उनसे कुछ करवाएं. वो दूसरे कौन है? जाहिर है मुस्लिम्स है, जाहिर है मुस्लिम्स मेजॉरिटी में उस समय, और उस समय तो मुस्लिम्स की जनसंख्या ज्यादा थी ना प्री इंडिपेंडेंस, लेकिन फिर भी कम थी रिलेटिवली. तो सावरकर ने एक बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग क्या कहें, कैलकुलस ऑफ पावर का एक वो दिया. ये बहुत अलग है गोलवलकर से. सावरकर ने कहा कि मुस्लिम्स को इंडिया में रहना चाहिए. बिल्कुल नहीं कह रहे कि मुस्लिम्स कहीं और चले जाएं, इंडिया में रहना चाहिए, लेकिन हिंदू के लेवल पे नहीं रहेंगे. हिंदू से वो हर समय सेकंड लेवल पर रहेंगे, लेकिन रहेंगे. इसका मतलब क्या है? इसका मतलब है कि हिंदूज और मुस्लिम साथ रहेंगे, पर हिंदूज मुस्लिम पर पावर एक्सरसाइज करेंगे, और स्टेट को उस पावर एक्सरसाइज करने में मदद करनी है. वो सिस्टम्स बनाने हैं, वो इंस्टीट्यूशंस क्रिएट करनी है. फॉर इंस्टेंस, आज ये चल रहा है मध्य प्रदेश में, बार बार ये सब ज्यादा होता है कि उर्दू भाषा का इस्तेमाल नहीं होना. पर्शियन वर्ड्स को बिल्कुल जेनोसाइड ऑफ लैंग्वेज है, एक शब्द नहीं आना. सावरकर ने उस समय कहा था कि संस्कृत इज द क्या था, ब्रेन ऑफ द रेस, Sanskrit is the brain of the race, Hindu. You know, racialized linguistics. And also kind of a craziness of imagining the brain as a language. You know, Savarkar ka statement. In that sense, Muslims rahenge, lekin Sanskrit raj karega. Raj not in the abstract sense, but power exercise karega. Just education. जैसे रोजमर्रा की जिंदगी में ब्यूरोक्रेसी में हर मोमेंट पे हिंदू नॉन हिंदू पर खासकर मुस्लिम पर पावर एक्सरसाइज करेगा, लेकिन मुस्लिम रहेगा. और पावर सबसे ज्यादा कब कामयाब होता है? जब अदर मान लेता है उसको, है ना? जब अदर मान लेगा, मुस्लिम मान लेगा कि चलो यही है रियलिटी, हमें यही रहना है और इसी इक्वेशन में रहना है. ये सावरकर का फॉर्मूला था फॉर अ काइंड ऑफ peaceful exercise of power through the most violent means, eventually. इसके लिए हिंदुत्व का एक specific strategy और एक concept इजाद किया सावरकर ने, जो बहुत पढ़ोगे तो बहुत मतलब अजीब सा. सावरकर's thinking was borrowed from Christianity a lot. So Hindudom, he says, is a clear borrowing from Christendom. है ना? Clear है. Imperialist Christianity. एक कोई अजीब सा सपना देखा जा रहा था कि हिंदू इंपीरियलिज्म होगी एक दिन. लेकिन हिंदुत्व एक और चीज उन्होंने बोला. सावरकर ने लिटरली क्या बोला कि हिंदुत्व इज पॉलिटिकल हिंदुइज्म बियॉन्ड हिंदुइज्म, इन द सेंस कि हिंदुइज्म इज द थियोलॉजिकल पार्ट, द रिलीजियस पार्ट, द टेक्सचुअल पार्ट, द ऑफिशियल इंस्टीट्यूशनल पार्ट. यह है हिंदुइज्म. ठीक है, हिंदुत्व नहीं है. हिंदुत्व इसके थ्रू डे टू डे, मोमेंट टू मोमेंट हिंदू लाइफ है. तो हिंदुत्व इज अकॉर्डिंग टू सावरकर हिंदू लाइफ, मोमेंट टू मोमेंट. और इसमें सावरकर ने जो मेटाफर इस्तेमाल की अपनी भाषा, बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग है, वो थी किसी जीव की जो दूसरे जीवों से खतरा महसूस करता है. तो क्या होता है, एक जीव जब लगता है कि कोई दूसरा प्रेडेटर आसपास आ रहा है तो उसके एंटीना निकल जाते हैं, वो अपने आप को बिल्कुल उस वो उस पॉस्चर में ले आता है कि दूसरे के खिलाफ तैयार हूं मैं लड़ने के लिए. लाइफ हैज परपेचुअल वॉर अगेंस्ट द अदर प्रेडेटर, द अदर जीव. हिंदुत्व, ही सेड, वाज द रेडीनेस फॉर दिस डेंजर. हिंदुत्व वाज अ डिफेंसिव पैरानॉइड, डिफेंसिव एग्रेसिव स्ट्रेटजी बियॉन्ड एंड थ्रू हिंदुइज्म, विच इज द कलेक्शन ऑफ दोज टेक्स्ट्स, दोज institutions, those documents which taken together could be called Hindu religion. Now, of course, if you take all of them like any multiplicity in a, you know, in a system which has so many years of collected literature, you will find many kinds of things. You'll find many kinds of things, some of which will have a certain, well, appeal. But Ambedkar, of course, did the other thing, which you were right to point out. What Ambedkar did was he demystified the beautiful, so to speak, part of Hinduism for its essential logic, which was, he said, the logic of hierarchy and caste. You know, so again, a particular operation has to be conducted vis-a-vis Hinduism, and a particular political grasp of Hindutva must be made, where Hindutva must be seen in its most radical form, which is not organizational Hindu, which is still more institutional, but which is Hindu of the single Hindu. Every single Hindu has his or her antenna up. In that sense, it is final mobilization, which Savarkar had in mind. But of course, Savarkar also had cultural mobilization in mind. So language is one area, jahan pe har Hindu ko practice karni hai ki Hindu bhasha mein bolni hai. Education, har cheez mein, har choti choti rozmarra ki cheez, wo hai Hindutva. तो ये कहना कि हिंदुइज्म अच्छा है, हिंदुत्व बुरा है, हिंदू मींस नथिंग टू मी एट लीस्ट, बिकॉज ये पूरी चीज एक स्पेसिफिक डिस्कोर्स और स्ट्रैटेजी जो हिस्ट्री में कार्यान्वित हुआ है उसके वीजे भी देखने की जरूरत है. आज जब ये चीज इस हद तक पहुंच गई है, तब एब्सोल्युटली अग्री विथ यू, बोथ द एनालिसिस मस्ट बी मेड एंड द पोजिशन मस्ट बी टेकन एज कंप्लीटली अपोजिंग एंड डिसमेंटलिंग दिस अपैरेटस. एब्सोल्युटली. Sorry, I can't see. Praveen, ha, Praveen.
So, this talk of yours is having two things.
How? Okay, all right, maybe.
The first time I heard you speak on Buddha and his Dhamma at Hebron, 2016, you said that Anandabhavarai, this was the term you used, and you spoke on Buddha and his Dhamma, and you said that it is making the students of Jain think then.
Yeah.
And now, today when you speak on Buddha and Dhamma, or let's say December 6, 1990,
yeah.
1956 yeah. and 1992,
yeah.
You're trying to make two religions speak to each other in contradiction to Hinduism or Hindutva. Mm. Ambedkar's, it is almost like the moment you say that December 6, 1956 is the invention of religion.
Okay, cut.
You're calling it as neo Buddhism. In your text, Ambedkar and other models, you say that Ambedkar picks from the historical roster of religions. And having that from your book, you also say that Dalit as an element, Dalit as
yeah.
an element of sentence to come in.
Yeah.
So when Ambedkar is from 1952 to 1956, when Ambedkar is negotiating himself with Buddhism,
mm-hmm.
he's dealing, reading, writing on Buddhism.
Correct.
Where is the Dalit in that?
Or
Dalit is completely dispersed. Ambedkar is disposing the Dalit.
Okay.
Ambedkar is going with Buddha and Buddhism.
I'll talk about it. Yeah.
One is this. Mm. The second is, when you say that with the December 6, 1992, there is a modern Muslim. This modern Muslim, it is not the modernity of Muslim is coming in 1919 in India. The modernity of the Muslim is there in 1930s in Aligarh.
Sure.
And also in the 1947 in the partition. So,
okay.
How do you suffice your arguments?
Or,
and when you take both of them to be together, I don't think the 56 and the 92 are together.
No, of course they are not.
It is just we are forcing them to be together. For the fact that they happened even the same day, it is almost like entering into syllogism. This is one. And the other thing is, it is very important that you mention Ka and RC and all. It is, either expanding or taking from your own book, last one. Muslims for the very first time have accepted Ambedkar only in the Ka and RC. Even
yeah.
in 1992, Muslims did not say that we are the people of India. In Shaheen Bagh, the preamble was displayed, the image of Ambedkar was displayed. And Muslim, what is happening in Shaheen Bagh? Along with Ambedkar, there is also somebody called N.K. Gandhi. And there is also constitution. Can Muslims see Ambedkar independently is the question.
Right.
Muslims are unable to see Ambedkar independently. They want to take together Gandhi alone.
Yeah.
And now when I see today's lecture of yours with your Ambedkar and other immortals, coronavirus association and the two books and today's lecture.
Mm-hmm.
And also one thing, in the last lecture that you gave, the public lectures in 2019, there you emphasized on Buddhist International.
Mm-hmm. Which I spoke
and
to
today. Today the term changed to Buddhist hegemony.
No, anyway, finish call, then I'll speak. Yeah.
And today the term changed to Buddhist hegemony. So,
no, absolutely.
So now things are actually getting mixed up.
No. Yeah,
so
okay.
How do we, and the last thing is this. There are certain section of Buddhists and also Ambedkarites who believe that there was something called Saket in the very site called Ayodhya. Today morning there was a discussion between some young Baksa people and we all discussed. As an young Ambedkarite, how do we locate, there is a slogan, rebuild Bapi. You as a scholar of Ambedkar or let's say Buddhism, who has worked on let's say liturgy, religion, what should a young Ambedkarite pick?
Yeah. So, thank you, Praveen. Again, you have a very, very large set and very important set of questions. So that last discussion, maybe we will have separately. It's something we'll have separately. But let me just go over the first three questions. Now, since you quote my book to me, it's possible, let's put it like this. It's possible that some things that I say now do not completely go with my book. It's possible. I myself might not be aware of it. I might be half aware of it. And I'll thank you for pointing them out. But of course, I'll discuss those points that you brought out. But it's possible that I am hopefully not contradicting, but modifying my own thinking, trying to build new sets of conceptual tools, or making new observations, analysis of things that are around me. Because since that book, so much challenges us to think through in terms of our historical reality, no? So I'm not saying it's not possible that I'm saying things which are different from what I said in my book. But the things that you point out specifically. Now look, the first thing that you point out, I speak of, or I'll just say things that are coming to my mind directly. I spoke of Buddhist hegemony. No, I spoke of Buddhist internationalism as the vision that Ambedkar had. Absolutely, there is no hegemony there in terms of the vision. But of course, one part of that internationalism is to exercise a certain hegemony. Hegemony must be understood in the most constructive sense here, in this case. Why? Because in the state system, you both want to influence others to move in directions that you think is better for the general idea of human society at an international level, and you do it through certain strategies. That is hegemony. But of course, hegemony is very, very complicated, and you're right to point that out, because hegemony requires genuine equality of participation in the process of politics, both internationally and nationally. Now, in Indian society, you can have constitutional equality, but you'll have no real social equality. Ambedkar pointed that out. In capitalism, bourgeois equality is not equality at all when you compare the capitalists and the working classes. So there, hegemony becomes a mask, clearly, for the continuation of a certain kind of class power, caste power, and so on. At the same time, some sort of a hegemony is always in operation, at least a strategy for that, insofar as you want to determine a part of state power, institutional power. Now, all I said today was, Ambedkar was interested in that. I don't think you will disagree with me, but Ambedkar was always interested in modifying the workings of state power towards greater equality, towards a certain kind of fairness, eventually towards better community, deeper community. You know, he was trying to do that. But of course, the state was an instrument of trying that out. At the international level, there was no one state. He had hardly any immediate relationship with any particular Buddhist state. But yes, in his addresses, because he was addressing people from all over the world, a lot of them coming from Buddhist countries, he did address them as someone who both wanted to transmit a fundamental vision of equality in comparison and in competition with Marx, which was communism, as opposed to that Buddhism, with the same aim, which is equality, but also said that Buddhism will have a different understanding of the state than communism will have. And he gave it a name, no? A well-known name. But he wanted to make it better than bourgeois democracy, or Brahmanical democracy, if there can be such a thing. He called it democracy. Buddhism and democracy in that speech at Kathmandu, he brought together. As different from what he called dictatorship, in the case of dictatorship of the proletariat in Lenin and in Marx. So that was the level at which he was speaking and thinking, with a certain interest in exercising hegemonic influence, but in his own life, that did not at all
I mean, there was no way, both in terms of historical reality, but also in terms of his own life, which ended in 15 days, in terms of doing that. What survived was the fundamental greatness of his vision, which was, well, now we come to the other question, which was what? What name to give it? When I say Neo-Buddhism, Ambedkarite Buddhism, these are names that history has, from Ambedkar onwards, has sort of transmitted to us. But of course, you're right. What happens to Dalit in this configuration, in this sort of a flurry of names? It is interesting that you're in that period, the name Dalit does not really emerge in the way that a new sequence emerges after Ambedkar, which is in Maharashtra particularly in the 60s to 70s, which is the Dalit Panthers, with the kind of razor-edged, you know. But again, Gail Ombud pointed this out, that with Dalit Panthers, we have a tendency of making it entirely theoretical, cultural, literary, and sort of at the level of ideas. But Dalit Panthers also had a strong interest in power. So to that extent, Ombud said, and I take it very seriously, that the analysis of Dalit politics, and that, there you're right, this is new thinking that is coming to me through other people I'm reading, which in Ambedkar and Immortals I hadn't read so well. That the anti-caste movement as an movement of revolution and emancipation with deeper roots going to ancient Indian Buddhism and so on and so forth is coming to Dalit movement, but Dalit movement also has a certain specific departure, a specific sort of a specific a state of modern sort of intervention, and that is the intervention of power. Now, that power does not actually come to the Dalits, but it becomes a new paradigm, horizon of politics. In a way, the Mandal Commission intervention becomes a certain new, huge explosion, visible explosion, which was already prepared by the grounds of a certain marginalized but effective stakes in state power, which is Dalit politics. In Ambedkar, you don't get that, you're right. But you get the lineaments, the structure of the interest of the marginalized people to have an interest in state power, but not state power in the same shape as the Brahmanical or bourgeois state. So at the same time, you see, a biographical element has to be brought in here. Between 1950 and 1956, whatever I have read, and this has been there when I was working on Ambedkar and Immortals. From 1950 to 1956, you can see Ambedkar relatively moving out of the mainstream orbit of Indian politics after his resignation and becoming more and more passionately immersed in his writings, particularly on Buddhism. I mean, it is of course not a total thing, but a relative change of emphasis. And to me, it seems to me that this tremendous immersion into his Buddhist thinking was to actually be able to, as exhaustively and systematically as possible, to lay out this vision for a certain emancipatory field for all of humanity. But being exactly the man he was, which is from the depressed classes, from the ex-untouchables, from the untouchables, which he always said, I'm from my people. I'm not just part of people like formal democracy, Indian people. I'm from the minorities. In that sense, he wanted that application of the internationalist fundamental vision to the specific situation of the Dalits. There, even the word Dalit might not be there so clearly, but the intensity is there. But you're right to point this out. There's a lot of debate in post-Ambedkar, after Ambedkar. And remember, Praveen, you were there at Nagalok when this person, who was a young person then, when we met him, he was in the 70s, he was actually one of the people who converted with Ambedkar. And when some of us spoke of Nava-Buddhism or Neo-Buddhism, he was so irritated. He said, what is New Buddhism? There is only Buddhism. Just say Buddhism, don't say anything else. Just don't say anything else. Even before that, I had spoken in the Ingenue once on conversion. There was a person, a Sikh person, a Buddhist Sikh. he came to me and said, same thing. Why do you speak of Dalit? Buddhist? Ho gaya, the job is done. Everything is okay, but don't say Dalit. Now the thing is, these are contested questions depending on who puts what kind of investment in terms of subjective intensity, but also political, you know, collective intensity. But to me, you see, what is interesting is that even if there is such a strong, intensive kind of a re-debating over the names, the fundamental principle remains the same, which is the principle of the vision of equality and a certain kind of true liberty, or what equal liberty, as my friend Sharad calls it, equal liberty, so that in true community can be created. The name is always a search. So the person who spoke to me and said Buddhist, Sikh bolo, said Buddhist bolo, Sikh nahi, Buddhist bolo. Ya usse pehle Nawa Buddhism nahi bolo. Ye ek search hai naam ka. Wo aaj bhi chal raha hai. So when I spoke of Muslim now, Muslim, see, you're right. Modern Muslim, I don't mean in some cultural sense. Modern Muslim, I don't mean in the sense of, you know, the books you write and your attitude. All of that is there. World over, these debates. I mean modern in that specific sense. Anything which happens as a result of a division in history is modern, which has to live its discontinuity with history. That is modern. In that sense, Muslim is the name of this modernity. What religious content to give it, how to configure it, is again the search of the... So the question is, Muslim, what is the name of Muslim today? That is the search for all of us, including the Muslims. That is the search of all of us in history, sometimes as Jews, sometimes as Dalits, sometimes as whoever. But that search itself is not localized to the Muslim, to one community. It is always a universal search. It's a search with others. That is what I was trying to say. You know? Now, what else did you say? In terms of, Buddha and his Dhamma. Okay. Now, see, no, I don't think there's any contradiction. It's a personal thing. You're right. When I spoke as the first few days of the gathering, that those tremendous gatherings that used to take place at the ad block, I spoke on Buddha and his Dhamma. I called it a book of intelligence. An intelligence which is a joy. And I still say it. I still say it. What is that intelligence? It is the intelligence which is able to evaluate your own position in history, including a religious position, through the most egalitarian, open, universal, cosmopolitan means. Imagine the freedom you'll have, or I'll have, when I'll say I'm a Buddhist, totally committed to doing it, and yet I'll evaluate the name Buddhist according to some principles, which is everyone's principles. Not just mine or yours. You know, so in that sense, it is a book of intelligence, a book of joy. And I maintain it. I still feel that, I still have that feeling with that book. But of course, there are certain, because I've also been, as you know, involved with some other groups in Pune and other places who have been reading Buddha and his Dhamma as contemporary collective exercises of reading. So many questions have come up, which I don't want to talk about today. But some questions have come up from different groups, including feminist groups. Those we'll discuss when the time comes. And those questions, I would like to think about. Not because they're coming from history, but they are coming from today. Yeah? Huh? And yeah, Shaheen Bagh, last question. Shaheen Bagh and Ambedkar. Well, this is, you know, Gandhi is there, Ambedkar is there, Kaifi is there, Sahir is there, so many are, Gauri Lankesh is there, everyone is there. Why? Because none of them can speak on behalf of Shaheen Bagh. This is the thing. Shaheen Bagh has to speak on its own behalf. People have to speak on their own voices. And to do that, they will use traces of words, not words, traces of words. So when they say Ambedkar, don't take it, I don't take it as full-fledged Ambedkar. It's a trace. When they say Gandhi, don't take it as a full-fledged Gandhi who historically is clearly opposed to Ambedkar and indeed created the worst kind of blackmail for Ambedkar. But at Shaheen Bagh, in that particular moment in history, it is a trace of Gandhi which Gandhi probably himself wouldn't recognize. But it is this defamiliarization in history, which makes us. And yet we make our unfamiliarity with ourselves speak through known figures. Sometimes Ambedkar, sometimes Gandhi, sometimes someone else. So I don't think those should be taken as consolidated judgments on X, we are with X or Y, or we are for. Of course, at the same time, there are questions. See, of the preamble itself, since you brought it. Yes, there's a constitutional side to this, and the preamble was spoken again and again and again. But you see, even with the preamble, I heard recently, Malik told me, that you people had done a kind of performance of the preamble, but you actually presented the Ambedkar preamble. That created a questioning, if not a division. So at every moment, including the history of the preamble, there is some division which is possible. Which division becomes a scission, polarization, violent, and which division becomes an opening onto a new future, we'll ourselves have to take responsibility for. But it doesn't mean the preamble is the preamble. Even the Constitution is a very interestingly disparate document, particularly if you take Ambedkar's speeches. No, see, the historical division, not in the preamble as a preamble, you're right. In the, suppose someone says, "Arey, isme to words nahi hai, jo hua tha mujhe Malik ne bataya. Ye to words nahi hai jo main jis preamble ko janta hu." To kehte hain, "Arey, ye dusra preamble hai." To koi kya kahega? Kehta, "Arey, preamble bhi ek se do hote hain." समझ रहे हो ना? हाँ, ये होना है ना, क्योंकि कुछ चीजें हम सोचते हैं कि कम से कम कुछ चीज तो है जो बिल्कुल फिक्स्ड है, वो नहीं बदलती. सनातन सिर्फ हिंदू की प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, सनातन हम सबकी प्रॉब्लम है. कुछ सनातन हम चाहते हैं, लेकिन हिस्ट्री में कोई चीज सनातन नहीं होती, और उसके साथ हमको जीना है, वो बहुत डिफिकल्ट है. कभी कभी वो बहुत वायलेंट होता है. कैसे आपने बोल दिया, कैसे आप किसी और का ला रहे हैं, जेल में डाल दो उसको. कभी ऐसा होता है, कभी होता है कंफ्यूजन होता है, अरे ये तो प्रियम्बल हम नहीं जानते थे, कहां से आ गया. फिर होता है जेन्युइन इन्वेस्टिगेशन, कि अच्छा ऐसा भी हुआ था क्या, अंबेडकर ने ऐसा बोला था, क्या था उसके पीछे, किसके साथ क्या होगा, वो तो पता चलेगा करके ही ना. सो दिस इज द वे आई लुक एट इट, रादर देन एज अ कंसोलिडेटेड पिक्चर, कि ये हो गया, दैट इज इट, ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट. बट एट द सेम टाइम यू आर राइट, वी नो वेरी वेल कुछ मोमेंट्स होते हैं जब देयर इज अ वायलेंट एक्सक्लूजन of some things, absolutely. And we have sense enough, and we have, you know, experienced the world badly enough to know when that moment comes. And in JNU, we learned it the hard way, because JNU was relatively very sort of secure and happy till some time back. But now we know when that moment comes. So yeah, that much I will say, Praveen. Otherwise, we will continue to talk. खाने वाने का भी टाइम है. हाँ हाँ, आई नो
अपकमिंग एक लेक्चर सीरीज हो रहा है, वापस से ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहे हैं अंबेडकर और कुछ आइडियाज पे, कुछ सेट ऑफ आइडियाज पे, जैसे लिबर्टी, इक्वालिटी, फ्रेटर्निटी, मानुष की और हैप्पीनेस. तो ये लेक्चर सीरीज का डिटेल्स हम डाल देंगे. और सेकेंड बात है कि 8:30 को एक मार्च हो रहा है गंगा से चंद्रभागा रिगार्डिंग बाबरी मस्जिद, तो उसको ज्वाइन कीजिए. और है कि थॉमस भाई अपने साथ वो कुछ बात
रखते हैं, इसको उतार रहे हैं. बट थैंक यू फॉर योर अटेंशन, थैंक यू वेरी मच.